Hello. Welcome to an adventure. It is me, Anthony Wright Day Hernandez, Community Collections Archivist here at Virginia Tech. And hopefully you all can see and hear me, and there's some low music in the background that isn't too disruptive, and I hope everything's good. As always, it is an adventure just getting the stream up and running. Today was, no, I am not restarting Windows right now. Thank you so much, computer. It's a live program. And 10 minutes before I hit go live, the Ethernet port that provides all of the internet for the entire stream was not providing any internet at all. So I think we're live. I think you can see and hear me. I hope you can see and hear me. But we may have, oh geez. One second. Because my computer is being silly. And if you're chatting, I don't know it. We're just going to try and get that music back and make it so that I can see the chat again, because the computer has decided I should not have those things. One moment. Just going to make it so I can see you. And then we will dive into this stream. I do have some wonderful things to share with you today. Show me my chat. Right, so we have lost the music. I understand this. I'm working on trying to get that to come back. Hello, computer. Anyway, I hope that you're having a good Wednesday. This is so much fun. There we go. I have internet again on this machine. We have music. There is chat. I can see the chat now. Hooray. Yeah, the music went away. Captions are back. Great. Thank you. I have to just not touch that computer, because for some reason, the slightest movement and the internet quits working on it. So we're just gonna not shift it side to side, because that turned out to be a bad idea. Anyway, welcome to an adventure, as I said. This, of course, being Archival Adventures, the weekly archives streaming show that I do from here at Newman Library at Virginia Tech. We look through things from the archives together. This going out to two channels, twitch.tv/VTULstudios, which is the library's channel, as well as to my own channel, twitch.tv/Rogan27. And it is nice to have you all join me. Before I dive into the collection that we're going to be looking at today, I do want to, as always, read the land acknowledgement and the labor acknowledgement. There's another term for the labor portion, but I can't think of what it is. Anyway, Virginia Tech acknowledges that we live and work on the Tutelo and Monacan people's homeland, and we recognize their continued relationships with their land and waterways. We further acknowledge that legislation and practices like the Morrill Act of 1862 enabled the Commonwealth of Virginia to finance and found Virginia Tech through the forced removal of Native nations from their lands, both locally and in Western territories. We understand that honoring Native peoples without explicit material commitments falls short of our institutional responsibilities. Through sustained, transparent, and meaningful engagement with the Tutelo and Monacan peoples and other Native nations, we commit to changing the trajectory of Virginia Tech's history by increasing Indigenous student, staff, and faculty recruitment and retention, diversifying course offerings, and meeting the growing needs of all Virginia tribes and supporting their sovereignty. We must also recognize that enslaved Black people generated revenue and resources used to establish Virginia Tech and were prohibited from attending until 1953. through Inclusive VT, the institutional and individual commitment to Utprosim, that I may serve in the spirit of community, diversity, and excellence. We commit to advancing a more diverse, equitable, and inclusive community. Okay. Thank you, as always, for supporting me in routinely sharing that acknowledgement. I'm gonna go ahead and drop a link to it over here. I may have misspelled it. V-T-A-C-K-N-O-L. I did misspell it. We're off to a great start today. One second. There's an L in there. There we go. So the collection for today is the Michael Two Horses collection. You can find the finding aid by typing !! Finding aid. That'll link you to a little bit of additional information there about the collection. But basically, Michael Two Horses, I've got a biographical note here, I'll read it, was a scholar, researcher, and activist. From the fall of 2003 until the time of his death in late December 2003, he was a visiting instructor in the American Indian Studies program and the Humanities program within the Department of Interdisciplinary Studies at Virginia Tech. He was also a member of the Virginia Tech Commission on Equal Opportunity and Diversity. I think the link to the online obituary will work. I'm just going to click it and find out. It's always iffy when there's links put into finding aids, because you never know if what they're linking to is still going to be there. Michael Two Horses, who was affiliated with the Sicangu, Lakota, and Wahpekute Dakota tribes, passed away. So this is from the obituary. At his home in Blacksburg, Virginia, he was 50 years old. Looking for more about him, since that's what they linked to in the finding aid. So I want to learn more about this person whose papers we're looking at. Two Horses received his undergraduate degree in cultural anthropology from Washington State University and his MA from the University of Arizona in American Indian Studies. He completed a year of study at Kansas School of Law in the Tribal Law Program and then opted to pursue his master's degree and PhD from Arizona. His emphasis was on societies and cultures, law and public policy, and American Indian history. Two Horses was born in San Diego to Alberta Mariana Bertino and David Two Horses Jordan, and adopted at 6 months of age by Edward and Sadie Lutieri. He served in Vietnam with the Navy's Military Assistance Command Vietnam Studies and Observation Group, stationed first at Tay Ninh and then at Long Tran, and was Petty Officer Second Class. He was survived by his father, Edward Thierry of Fort Lauderdale, Florida, his brother Albert Thierry of Palm Springs, California, and a large community of friends and colleagues. Two Horses will be remembered for his exhaustively brilliant research and writing and his passionately honest dedication to human rights, particularly with respect to American Indian treaty rights, spiritual rights, and cultural rights. During an escalation of the ongoing macaw whaling controversy, he formed the Coalition to End Race-Based Targeting of American Indian Nations, CERTAIN, in 2000. He went repeatedly to Naya Bay while anti-whaling forces were threatening school children, harassing the macaw people, and threatening the lives of the whalers. With CERTAIN, Two Horses engaged the opponents of the macaw's treaty rights in dialogue, countering their arguments in the media, taking photographs and witnessing to protect the macaw from further physical attack, and acting in conjunction with the Washington Human Rights Commission and the U.S. Coast Guard to protect the lives and rights of the macaw people. Two Horses was equally engaged in expanding the scholastic dialogue. He persistently pointed out elements of racism in the dominant cultural perspective on American Indians, in the face of pedagogical tendencies to trivialize these concerns. He declined to acquiesce to the marginalization in the discourse. He investigated the growing rift between mainstream environmentalists and tribal nations across the United States and Canada, and the way that much environmental writing fails to consider the role of indigenous peoples in shaping the so-called wilderness. They did not want to acknowledge, he wrote, in much the same way as colonial writers did, that the human hand has always shaped this continent, and that in creating false constructs of pristine wilderness and of cities as fallen areas, such writing tends to avoid completely the contested lands where members of marginalized races or classes live, and fails to deal with the concept of national sacrifice areas in human terms, in as much as the Indians, Hispanics, black people, Asian people, and poor white people living in those areas are sacrificed as well. These are zones where uranium mines and coal mines and their pollution of groundwater or toxic waste dumps are located without exception in proximity to marginalized people. He was relentless in his opposition toward plastic shamans, people white or native, who hawk Indian spirituality. They abstract bits of our culture, he said, and then they sell them as the genuine article, something along the lines of taking parts of the Catholic liturgy and extracting the cool parts and then performing those parts for money. This is the deepest essence of what they do, and it is comprised of both snake oil sales and of a deep disrespect for native cultures. So, sounds like a very interesting person who had a lot to talk about. As noted, he was an activist, was involved with treaty rights exploration as well as instruction on actual native culture. So we're gonna look at his papers today. I do know a couple of items in the collection that are interesting. Got two rather large boxes. If there's something listed in the finding aid that you think sounds interesting and you'd like to make sure I cover it today on stream, do let me know, because I will prioritize requests from the viewers. Otherwise, I'm gonna just pull out things that look interesting to me and we'll take a look at them. Because I've only seen a few things from here. But I'm gonna start by just pulling out the first few folders from the collection. And we'll see what we have. Let me switch over so that you all can see what I'm going to be looking at here. So the first folder that we have here is titled Aboriginal Organizations and Services, British Columbia, 1999. I have no idea what's in this folder. Confirmed visual on box one, folder one. Thank you, Portico. All right, so this appears to be an actual publication from the Ministry of Aboriginal Affairs in British Columbia, Canada. And I think there are a number of these things in this collection, not necessarily like guides specifically like this, but a number of what would be published resources that were used as references for Two Horses' work, instruction, research, etc. So we'll glance at them, and if they're interesting, we may spend some time with them. Otherwise, table of contents, First Nations, bands, tribal councils, affiliations, treaty offices, Métis organizations, services and agencies. So there's a listing with contact information for various, looks like just specifically First Nations groups in British Columbia. I don't know if anybody watching is in Canada. I know some of my regular viewers are in Europe or in Australia, but I don't know of anybody specifically in Canada. Yeah, this seems to mostly just be a directory of organization contact information from 1999. So interesting, not particularly something that we need to spend a lot of time with today, but interesting. Next folder is box one, folder two, Animal Liberation Primer, or primer. So that's generally like a base knowledge guide, a primer. And the Animal Liberation Primer, edited and compiled by someone. It's a little difficult to make out those words, but that's what it says. Edited and compiled by someone. So it's nice to know someone worked on it. Oh, wow. The old not so great printing. This is like 90s era. There's no date provided on this item, but I can tell just by looking at the quality of the printing and the font used and sort of the style of it. And this was an image that was printed and likely on a 90s era or early 2000s era machine. This booklet is dedicated to the hardworking men and women of the ALF. Today you will be branded a terrorist, but someday you will be remembered as a selfless warrior who dared to fight for what was right. The animals would thank you if they could. Keep up the good work. Produced to be a tool to empower the average person to make a significant difference in this world. It has been compiled from numerous sources into a condensed volume of Animal Liberation Tactics. Read this booklet once, and then twice, and then again. Make sure you know it inside and out before setting out to do anything. ALF is an international organization that seeks the total elimination of animal abuse and suffering at the hands of humans. The ALF has no formal leadership and no real membership. It is made up of individuals working in small groups called cells that do nonviolent direct action. For security reasons, there is no communication between cells, so that if one cell is infiltrated or arrested, it will not affect any other ALF cell. Liberates animals from places and situations of abuse. Fur farms, laboratories, factory farms, etc. So this is very active activism, would be this type of thing. Interesting. Economic sabotage versus live liberations. So this is clearly not a document that Two Horses wrote. Or at least I would assume not, because it is clearly something that was saved as images and then printed out. And so that to me implies that this was not something authored by Two Horses. Anyway. We can always explore this further if people are interested in it, but I'm probably going to move on to some of the other items that are more directly related to Two Horses' work with indigenous population and things like that. Let's see. Arizona Territory Gourd Society Incorporated. I do not know anything about this. We have the bylaws of the Arizona Territory Gourd Society. Being a nonprofit charitable organization, the corporation shall not have nor issue capital stock. Yes, yes. What are your purposes? Who are you? Tell me what. The purposes and are. Yes, okay, great. The heading purposes just tells me there are purposes set out in this document, which is so helpful. The corporation shall have members. directors, resignations, filling of vacancies, special meetings, place of meetings, quorum, officers. Lots of bylaws here. Nothing explicitly telling me who they are. I mean, this one is at least a little bit of information. Amendment to the bylaws on membership. The membership of the society shall be American Indians who are military veterans, men and women, immediate relatives of veterans, such as spouses, sons, daughters, and others such as non-veterans, who, because of their outstanding achievements or contribution or other outstanding attributes, but are also American Indian, who are invited by society members to become nominated for membership by the membership committee. They have to be at least 17, be a member or descendant of a member of an American Indian tribe. Hey, Shadows of Life, how are you today? Initiation period, membership committee. I still haven't found out what the purpose of this organization is. There's a lot of, here are the bylaws. Here's what this is. There's nothing about the purposes, even though there was a section titled purpose. And that said that the purposes of the organization were listed further in, but I never found them. And this appears to just be a second copy of the same document. So maybe not going to find out from this folder what the Arizona Gourd Society is all about. Oh, but we do have, after the bylaws, we have something that maybe will provide us some of our answers. Kiowa Gourd Dance by Kent Ware Sr. Historical Kiowa Gourd Society. The Kiowa Gourd Dance is culturally tied to a famous Kiowa legend. Without knowledge of that legend, one cannot fully understand the significance of the Gourd Dance. The following is one version of how the Kiowa Gourd Dance got started. This is called the Red Wolf Legend. A long time ago, there was a Kiowa warrior who got separated from his hunting party and had traveled a long distance, hoping to join his people in their summer encampment. He suddenly heard a strong and clear voice singing a melodious song, a song that he had never heard before. The beautiful sound carried him to the top of a nearby hill, where he saw a beautiful red wolf at the bottom of the grassy ravine. Red Wolf held in his right paw a gourd that he shook with a pulsating movement. His body moved rhythmically up and down in tempo with the beautiful songs pouring from his long, lean throat. The warrior listened throughout the night to those beautiful songs, and the power of the songs moved him in both body and spirit. And then Red Wolf said to the warrior, "I have given to you a new dance with many beautiful songs. This is a gift for you to take to your people. These songs and this dance will remain with the Kiowas for as long as they protect and cherish these Kiowa ways. Tell your people to be proud as they enter the dance arena and remind the children to listen carefully, for this is how the music will live. Go now and teach the Kiowas what I have given you." After the warrior reached the Kiowa encampment, he related his experience with Red Wolf to all the people. The people listened and accepted the gourd dance with its beautiful melodies. To show their appreciation to Red Wolf, the Kiowas end each song with a wolf cry and a special shake of the gourd. The Kiowa Gourd Society was originally a warrior and chief's society dating from around 1838 when it was formed after one of the greatest battles in their history. The major battle at Wolf Creek was fought on a battleground of skunkberry bushes, which at that time were red and in full bloom. Those bushes became even more red with the blood from the warriors who fought that battle. And because they survived, the Kiowas regard the skunkberry bushes and berries as a powerful medicine symbol, and the berries are also called feast food. Today, the red on the red side of the gourd blanket symbolizes the red of the skunkberry. In addition to the red skunkberries, the Kiowa Gourd Society has chosen as its symbols the whip, the rope, and the bugle. So I'm guessing that the Arizona Territory Gourd Society is probably related to this since it was in the same folder. There's some information here about the meanings of the different symbols. So, interesting, some cultural information there. A handwritten note about a meeting of the society, but no information on the year that that was, but apparently. It seems like maybe Two Horses wasn't just learning about the society, but possibly was involved with it. If they had information about specific meetings. The next one, the next folder in here is just called artwork. So this should be somewhat interesting to look at, I presume. I'm going to zoom out so that you all can hopefully see. Again, with the... My computer does not like to stay on during stream for some reason, and I don't know why. It just tried to go to sleep on me. I believe I have fixed the problem now, but we'll see. I'm going to zoom out a little bit here so that we can see the entire piece. Just refresh the focus there. And I'm going to do my best to pronounce things. I do not know specifically pronunciations, so I'm just going to be sounding them out. I don't know. I may get them wrong. That's all I'm going to say. Shi-Shi-Keibon, Apache Moccasins, Mike Two Horses. So we've got some felt on a folder, it looks like, just made to look like a pair of moccasins. That's the first item in the artwork folder. The rest of it, there's a sketchbook in here. So let's take a look at some of his art. Honestly, this is a better horse than I could do. It's actually a really good freehand sketch of a horse. Some notes. A couple more horses. These are really good. These are ink. And they are just, they're just sketches, and they're ink, and they are very evocative. You can definitely tell what is being drawn. Like, I could not do this well. Especially not Like, that's first try, because it's ink. There's some definite, like, practice in there to be able to do these. And horses, I have heard, are surprisingly difficult to draw properly. Yeah, these are really cool. Let's see. I'm gonna see if there's more stuff beyond horses, I think. I don't know, but I would imagine that possibly having the name Two Horses may have been part of the inspiration for wanting to draw horses. That one, we got to see, like, the backside of it. This is done with marker. And it's really good. These are... I'm not an artist. I've had some education in drawing, taken a couple of classes, but these are quite quite good, very interpretive, and yet realistic enough so that you know what you're looking at. That's a really neat sketchbook. It's basically entirely sketches of horses, which, why not? Let's see, I have, the next one is beadwork. Box one, folder five, beadwork. And this one, I think, is more of like a research file. Because there's a chapter here about beadwork. With some patterns. The patterns are really neat. But let's see. So it does look like there was some work done on actually designing a beadwork piece. The handwritten note says white beaded background, and then you've got the geometric shapes here. They're colored in with colored pencil to make a design. I don't know if these shapes are specifically called out in the reference material here. I don't think that they are. Thank you. Let's see, there's, again, some more research work with just general information about beadwork. Beadwork technique. When indigenous women first obtained beads for their embroidery, they sewed them to the buckskin in two ways. One of these prevailed among all the beadworkers of the American continent, and though it was never much used by the Western Sioux, we shall describe it first, since its wide use suggests that it may have been the earlier of the two. Overlaid or spot stitch. The technique of this stitch is substantially the same as that of quill work. That is, a thread of sinew strung with a few beads is attached to the buckskin by another sinew thread sewed across it, just as formerly a thread was sewed across a quill. Couching is the name given by white seamstresses to this method of attaching a narrow decoration without piercing it. And then figure 10 apparently shows that method in detail. Two threads are used, which are called the bead thread and the sewing thread. The end of the bead thread is attached to the buckskin, then the thread is strung with one, two, or possibly more beads and laid along the buckskin as the pattern demands. If the beads are all the same color, there may be as many as six or eight. Then the sewing thread is stitched over at right angles and into the buckskin, where it is carried along, as shown by the dotted lines, until a few more beads have been strung on the bead thread and the sewing thread emerges and is stitched across it. The beads closely pushed together conceal both threads entirely. The number of beads strung on the bead thread before it is stitched down depends on the fineness of the work and whether it has sharp curves. So I do know that this collection contains a number of research files. And Two Horses was a scholar of what academically is called American Indian Studies, and was a visiting professor here at Virginia Tech as an instructor in American Indian Studies here at Tech, as well as in the humanities. So I suspect that some of the materials in this collection were his own personal research files for topics that he would be providing instruction on. Sorry, one second. I forgot to put the paperclip back on. Well, and that plastic clip broke, so I guess I will not reaffix it. Ouch. We're gonna skip bibliographies, unless you're particularly interested in bibliographies, but they tend to not be the most interesting things. The next item I personally think is absolutely wonderful. This is an item. The folder is labeled Caucasian American Workbook. And I love this. I love this item so much. I have seen this item before. I have highlighted this item before, not on stream here, but as a tool for sort of educating people to understand the experience of indigenous people in this country, modern indigenous people in this country, I think it is an excellent tool. Basic Skills Caucasian Americans Workbook. Written by Beverly Slapin, illustrated by Annie Esposito, with a foreword by Doris Seeley. This item is actually still available for purchase, or at least it was a couple years ago last time I looked. And so I won't give away the entire book. But elementary students in the United States, at least when I was growing up, would have a book like this about Native Americans. And it was all about Native American culture and supposedly teaching students about who Indigenous Americans were in history, and presented Indigenous Americans as though they no longer existed, as though it was not a living culture, and in very stereotyped ways. So this workbook takes that concept and applies it to Caucasian Americans, which I just think is wonderful. Dedication. This book is for our little savages and for all boys and girls who love white people and animals. It's copyright 1990 and 94 for the piece that I have physically in front of me. Let's see. Note from the publisher. Our purpose for publishing the Basic Skills Caucasian Americans Workbook is to provide young readers with accurate accounts of the lives of the Caucasian American people who long ago roamed our land. Caucasians are as much a part of American life as they were 100 years ago. Even in times past, Caucasians were not all the same. Not all of them lived in condos or drove Volvos. They were not all yuppies. Some were hostile, but many were friendly. It is important for young people to study our Caucasian American neighbors in order to learn how they have enriched the heritage and history of all Americans. We hope that the youngsters who read these pages will realize the role that Caucasian Americans have played in shaping the United States, in making America the remarkable country that it is today. So this is the whole book is entirely tongue-in-cheek like that. From the note to the publisher, the dedication, it's all made to mirror what you would see in a book on Native Americans, to sort of show why they're badly done. Oh dear, we're getting a raid. Hello and welcome, Whimsies. Welcome in, everybody from 16-Bit Eric's stream. you are arriving at a very interesting moment, but it is great to have you here, and I hope that you had a good time over on Eric's stream. If you're new here or unfamiliar, this is a show that I do once a week from the archives at Virginia Tech, and I share materials from our archives. You would know me as Rogan27, and that is the channel that you came in on. This show actually goes out to the VTUL Studios channel as well as the Rogan27 channel. And I'm an archivist here at Virginia Tech, and I focus primarily on increasing representation of historically marginalized communities within our collections. Today we're looking at a collection of materials from the Michael Two Horses collection. Michael Two Horses was an Indigenous American and a visiting professor here at Virginia Tech for a while. And so yeah, welcome. The Historical Terms Command does not quite cover this workbook. And if anybody was watching and does not already follow Eric, 16-Bit Eric is a wonderful human who is an expert on all things RPG. So if you're at all interested in tabletop role-playing games, I highly suggest that you give him a follow. And if you really are just looking for just wonderful people who have whimsical positive attitude, I would also recommend following. The item that we have just arrived at is the Basic Skills Caucasian Americans Workbook, which is a parody book. It is parody of the types of publications about Native Americans that American elementary school students are given. And we just started looking at this. This is one of my favorite items in this collection. It's one of the only items that I'm somewhat familiar with from the collection. And it is made to reflect what workbooks about Native Americans look like and how they're written. This item is from the 90s. I believe there are more updated versions of it that are available. But everything from the dedication to the note from the publisher are very somewhat tongue-in-cheek, but very much a parody of the Native American workbooks. About the author, Beverly Slapen, the author who delighted many young readers with growing up Caucasian, I live in a condo, Caucasian blue eyes on his Volvo, and what's up, little white girl, has always been fascinated with and delighted by white people. A teacher whose love of white culture led her to intensive Caucasian studies, which she eagerly shares with her young students, Slapen writes, "What would America have been without the Caucasians themselves? With their magnificent shopping malls, their colorful polyesters, their factories, landfills, and parking lots, their soap operas, and their history." Slapen, a winner of the coveted Ishibashi Award, has previously collaborated with Annie Esposito on What's Up, Little White Girl, which Bookmark described as beautifully cadenced, sensitive prose, a fine choice for storytelling to groups or for reading individually, with time to savor the book's strong, quiet appeal. Both Slapen and Esposito look forward to their next project, the White People Pop-Up Book. It's excellently done parody. Like, excellently done parody. About the illustrator, Annie Esposito is a serious collector of Caucasian art and artifacts, including rugs, baskets, CDs, and Tupperware. Her sensitive and dramatic ethnic illustrations have earned her wide acclaim, including recognition by the Museum of the American Caucasian, the Society of Illustrators of Caucasians, and the Association of White People Hobbyists. Esposito is the illustrator of several books for children, including What's Up, Little White Girl, of which Library School Journal wrote, "Esposito's art is a triumphant mixture of symbolism and dramatic storytelling. It is handsome and eye-catching and highly stylized." Esposito particularly liked working on Basic Skills Caucasian Americans Workbook because of the beautiful patterns and rich Caucasian sources it incorporated. So you can see a little bit about how, like, these are the exact same sentences that you would have about authors working on books about indigenous people. Only they have subbed in white people things. So let's actually look at some of the book itself. Because I think it's really well done. It's very well done parody. I'm gonna not just start at the beginning. I'm just gonna jump to a page in the middle, and then we won't spend too much time on it. I love this piece. I think it is excellent at illustrating the way we have, as a culture, fetishized and fictionalized indigenous people. And so when it's turned on its head so that it's about Caucasians, instead it sort of shows how, those workbooks that I remember seeing in elementary school probably weren't all that accurate or good. Caucasian American clothing and fashion. The type of clothing the Caucasian Americans wore was determined by two things: the weather of their region, and a custom called fashion, with a pronunciation guide. In areas where it was very cold, Caucasian Americans used clothing made of leather, fur, and synthetics. Very often, people with vast quantities of sacred green paper, yuppies, wore only natural fibers and wouldn't be caught dead in synthetics. Poor people often wore synthetics. Sometimes fashion told people to dress in a way that made their bodies too hot or too cold. In areas where the weather was warm, people may have simply worn little clothing. But in order to dress fashionably, they may have worn clothes that heated their bodies. They were said to be slaves to fashion, whatever that may have meant. Caucasian Americans made clothing from almost everything imaginable. Tanned leather was used the most, especially by yuppies. Pants, jackets, dresses, and shoes were made of leather. Caucasian Americans also used cotton, which they cleverly planted and harvested. Sometimes they would decorate their clothing with beads, feathers, and pieces of metal and glass. Caucasian Americans also wove woolen blankets from sheep's wool to keep warm in winter, and wealthy Caucasian Americans wore tiny feathers called down, which were plucked from the bottoms of ducks. This down was very expensive, costing vast quantities of sacred green paper, and was stuffed into blankets and jackets. Yeah, Shadows of Life, it's excellently done. I'm not going to read too much of it because this is, as I said, there are newer versions of it, and it is an item that is, as far as I'm aware, still available for purchase. But I think it's great. Caucasian Americans especially loved their jogging shoes, which were very expensive and helped them run swiftly through the woods. A ritual some Caucasian Americans performed often was called the Sacred Yuppie Jogging Ceremony and was conducted with jogging shoes. Caucasian American women were constrained to wear tight clothing, and sometimes their shoes were very pointed at the front and had long sticks at the bottom. This made it very difficult to walk, and often they hurt their backs. Caucasian American women also painted their faces in strange ways to prepare for mating rituals, usually on weekends. Another thing Caucasian American women were obliged to do, especially just before mating rituals, was to remove almost all their body hair. This was done with sharp implements, and the ritual was called shaving and plucking. Another custom was reserved for the hair on Caucasian American women's heads. Women with long hair usually cut it, and women with short hair wanted it to be long. Women with light hair darkened it, and women with dark hair lightened it. Women with straight hair curled it, and women with curly hair straightened it. No one knows how these customs originated, but Caucasian American men seemed to have made the rules, and Caucasian American women seemed to have obeyed them. No one knows why. One method of control of the women was the fashion magazines, which told them what they had to do to their bodies. The fashion magazines, which were produced by the fashion chiefs, said that all women had to be tall and thin, so many women went on diets. No one knows the origin of that word, but some think it had to do with death, since many women died soon after becoming thin. And there's an illustration here of a Caucasian American preparing for the mating ritual. She has read the fashion magazines, changed her hairstyle, painted her face, removed her body hair by shaving and plucking, and is about to begin the diet ritual. And she's holding a skinny cola. And it is indeed a workbook. As said on the front, unscramble the letters to find the correct answer to fill in each blank. So number one there would be yuppies wouldn't be caught dead in synthetics. Yeah, so complete and utter parody of the type of, like, elementary school level workbook about indigenous people that was quite common in the United States in, like, the 80s and 90s. I do not know. I don't do elementary education today, so I don't know if workbooks like this have improved since then. But you can tell from the parody, because this rings 100% true with how indigenous culture is presented to elementary students. And if you're a white person watching this and you're like, well, this is stereotypical and it's overgeneralization and it's not accurate, or it provides one perspective on the culture without being as nuanced as the culture deserves. Indeed, this is accurate. It's not technically wrong, but it isn't the whole truth. And that oftentimes would be the case with a workbook such as this regarding Indigenous culture as well. And that's why it's one of my favorite pieces in the collection, because I just think it's excellently done. I think it's an excellent parody. Okay, let's see what else we have here. That one will be interesting. And again, if there's anything in the finding aid that you're particularly interested in me sharing, do let me know so that I can make sure that we get to it. That one looks good. Whoop! I tried to pull out the folder and accidentally grabbed two folders. Let's see. Okay, I will get back. We'll look at some of these items and then probably get to some more things. Shadows, yeah, it is amazing. And if you look up the Caucasian American Skills Workbook, I do believe it is currently still available for purchase. In a more modern version of it. So that, if you are interested in maybe getting a copy for yourself, I believe as late as a couple of years ago, I know it was still an item that you could find really easily. So this folder is called Columbus Teacher Resources. And as you know, the person whose papers these are was an activist and an Indigenous person, and so this is going to have a very particular lens on Christopher Columbus, that being an Indigenous person's lens on Christopher Columbus, which is not necessarily the same lens that people may have encountered in public school or even private education in the United States. So similarly to the Caucasian Americans workbook, this is providing a different perspective, which is useful for instruction. And as he was indeed a teacher, I presume that these things probably were used in his courses. This one is a book titled The Truth About Columbus, a Subversively True Poster Book for a Dubiously Celebratory Occasion by Professor James W. Lowen. So a dubiously celebratory occasion would be Columbus Day, which in many states today and at many higher education institutions, Columbus Day isn't really celebrated anymore, and instead Indigenous Peoples Day is observed. Virginia Tech has been one of those locations where we don't really emphasize Columbus Day anymore, and instead we highlight Indigenous Peoples Day. But I thought we would take a glance here at, there's a dog marked page. So, dog-eared page here. I don't know what was being bookmarked. Let's see. Oh, the center here is going to be the most interesting part for stream, I think.
All right. We'll just read like the opening paragraph here of the poster. I'm gonna zoom in a bit. The truth about Columbus. Christopher Columbus, and so I'm reading from an item that is a historical item. It is from a collection that, as I noted, has a very particular indigenous lens. And we're looking at this for educational purposes. I'm disclaimering partly because I do know that there are large portions of the Italian-American community that very much celebrate Christopher Columbus, and their perspective on their heritage is a different perspective than the one that is present in this collection. And I'm not in any way trying to denigrate their culture and their historical perspective on their past. So thank you for dropping in that note in the chat there, Lord Portico. As we review unedited historical documents on Archival Adventures, we may encounter words and phrases that are derogatory or harmful either now and or in their historical context. Please feel free to step away from the stream as desired for your own safety and well-being. But I do think that this item provides an interesting perspective and one that was not presented in the public schools that I attended in the United States when I was younger. So the truth about Columbus. Christopher Columbus was so important that we use him to divide history. The Americas before 1492 were our pre-Columbian. But what do we really know about him? Much of what American history books tell us isn't really so. Authors want to make a better Columbus myth. This poster matches wrong or distorted statements from 15 textbooks used in American classrooms with more accurate information based on primary sources. Primary sources come from people, including Columbus himself, who were there when it happened. What the history books leave out is also really important. Textbooks don't tell us why Europe reacted differently to Columbus than to earlier explorers. Even more important, they omit what Columbus did with the Americas once he encountered them. And they don't tell of the world-transforming effects that the Americas had on Europe. When you discover the truth about Columbus, you start to discover the truth about textbooks. Their errors aren't limited to Columbus, so you have to read them critically. Learning history makes getting involved in issues not just a memorizing of a lot of facts. So the poster is there. I'm wondering, trying to see the best way to present this. Well, I'll read a little bit from the book. I haven't spent a lot of time with this book. It's one that I knew existed and I had glanced at before. I like that they're tying it to primary sources and trying to point out errors or omissions. So that raises its credibility in my mind. Somebody was already living here. The first thing textbooks leave out is the fact that the Americas were already inhabited. That's not quite fair. Every textbook says that people lived in the Americas before Christopher Columbus landed. However, when textbooks swing into what they see as their main story, the settlement of the Americas by Europeans, Native Americans pretty much drop out. The omissions begin with their various presentations of Columbus. Indigenous people play bit parts in the Columbus story as textbooks tell it. In A History of the United States, Boorstein and Kelly devote 214 lines of text, almost 2,000 words, to the story of Columbus's four voyages to America. This is the longest account in any of the 15 books I have surveyed, yet in it, indigenous people get only 5 words. The natives called it Guanahani, and Columbus named it San Salvador. To be sure, A History of the United States goes on to allot its next 2 pages of text, 1 page of photos and a map, to American Indians. This tiny section of 1,250 words tries to cover 40,000 years and more than 400 societies from Peru to the Arctic in less space than Columbus gets. Several other books do much better than that. Four books allot their first chapter to Native Americans. The American Adventure, for example, gives three chapters, 40 pages, to the earliest immigrants. Discovering American History and the American People supply interesting information on Native Americans in the 20th century. At the other extreme, though, the American Pageant wins the honor of the worst and shortest treatment. It gives Indians before Columbus not a single paragraph and leaves them out of the 20th century as well. And this item is from 1992. So just kind of interesting to see the types of items that were collected by two horses in working on educating about so he was an educator in American Indian Studies and a scholar in a field that is called American Indian Studies. So we have an item here, a handout from OSPI, it looks like, teaching about Columbus in 1992 and beyond, a resource packet for teachers from the Colorado Indian Education Association and the Denver American Indian Education Advisory Council. Just gonna look, see what we learn, see what we find. Statement regarding the observance of the Columbus quincentennial anniversary by the National Indian Education Association, July 16th, 1992. I flipped to this page because it sounded interesting. The National Indian Education Association takes this opportunity to share the following perspectives about the Columbus quincentennial anniversary in 1992. These perspectives are offered in keeping with that part of the mission statement of NIEA, which advocates promoting educational research, educational advancement, and educational personnel development. The National Indian Education Association believes that the dominant European and Euro-American response to this anniversary year should entail a reflective and contemplative silence so that the indigenous voices can be fully heard. The NIEA believes that this year of 1992 should mark the beginning of an extended exploration of indigenous perspectives at all grade levels in all subject areas of American school systems. Such an exploration is required to counter the hundreds of years of Eurocentric conditioning that is responsible for institutionalizing monoculturalism in schools and communities everywhere. Only by integrating indigenous perspectives into world history can there be a meaningful global understanding about the consequences of two global hemispheres coming together on October 12, 1492. The NIEA seeks this global understanding so that the basic human rights of indigenous peoples of the Western Hemisphere will be respected and their cultures fully recognized for the many for their many contributions to the world. So, similar, honestly, to the types of things that we hear today about institutionalized systems of oppression and needing to address them. Unwritten chapters. Rethinking Columbus. A special issue of Rethinking Schools. Dedicated to the children of America, or of the Americas. It's a photocopy of a magazine, it looks like. Why rethink Columbus? Why rethink Christopher Columbus? Because the Columbus myth is basic to children's beliefs about society. For many youngsters, the tale of Columbus introduces them to a history of this country, even to history itself. The Discovery of America is children's first curricular exposure to the encounter between two cultures and to the encounter between two races. As such, a study of Columbus is really a study about us, how we think about each other, our country, and our relations with the people around the world. The Columbus myth teaches children which voices to listen for as they go out into the public or go out into the world, and whose to ignore. Pick up a children's book on Columbus. See Chris talk. See Chris grow up. Have ideas. Have feelings. In these volumes, the native peoples of the Caribbean are the discovered. Don't think or feel. And thus children begin a scholastic journey that encourages them to disregard the perspectives, the very humanity of people of color. I think that that is a very short and very descriptive explanation of systemic racism within elementary education in the United States. Why I'm not thankful for Thanksgiving. So I don't actually know for certain why we have this collection. Michael Two Horses was a visiting professor here at Virginia Tech at the time of his death. And I suspect that his papers were gathered and just brought to us after his death. I do not know who donated them or who decided that they would be put into our collections. I am very happy that we have them. The Columbus myth sounds weird to you. Shadows, if you don't mind sharing, I'm not sure where you're actually located, but that statement makes me think that you may not be in the United States. I would be curious to know sort of why the Columbus myth sounds weird. Oh, that book also came with an actual poster. It's a big poster. In full color of the truth about Columbus. Make sure I get it back into the folder where it belongs. Let's see, we have Two Horses' dissertation proposal, which is really thick. December 11th, 2001, introduction. Dissertation will focus on the need for, so this is unedited with notes on it. I'm not gonna, need for a contemporary history of problems of ideologies created at margins of the social mainstream, consisting primarily of conflicts between the ideologies of native peoples committed either by the necessity of subsistence or the necessity of maintenance of cultural structure to traditional means of food production in the cases to be examined, meaning hunting and trapping. Ideologies of non-native animal rights advocates engaged in opposing native hunters and trappers. And there are many editor's marks on there, which is good because it was a little hard to follow what was being said there. Oh, using the word myth for Columbus is weird because you don't see it as a myth and more of a story. I could see why that might feel strange. But mostly because we tend not to think of our own myths as myths. We think of historical stories as myths. So like the Greek mythology or Roman mythology, where we don't think of stories from our own society as mythology, even when they are. So like the Midnight Ride of Paul Revere is a story that is related and one that is often taught to children, and it's a myth. It is a story. It is a story meant to instill patriotism and to make the Revolutionary War interesting for elementary age children. But it is a myth. It is a modern myth of the United States of America. And in reality, there were multiple people involved in carrying the message. The actual phrasing used in telling the story differs from what was used in reality. And it's partly the story as it survives in the popular consciousness of today, stems from a poem that was written. And the poem is what sort of persisted into the modern day and became the story, and and that story lives in our minds as history, even though it's actually mythology. You would use the word legend. And so I think like Columbus and the tale of Columbus would be another sort of legend or myth of modern American culture. The Pilgrims, the First Thanksgiving. There are a number of tales that are told. Susan B. Anthony and the first American flag. So there are a variety of tales, often relating to early American history, that at least in America, we learn them as children, and our understanding of them never goes beyond the narrative we're taught as kids. We never actually learn the more nuanced, real history because we're presented with an entertaining narrative as children, and then that era of history is considered to have been taught. And unless you want to specialize it as a student of history, when you get to a collegiate level, you're not likely to encounter more of the more fully realized, accurate history. And so it sort of becomes a common mythology of our culture. So I think some of the materials we've looked at today are intended to specifically address that problem by either suggesting that we teach differently to elementary age children, by trying to advocate for telling the real history rather than the sort of sanitized version that is told. Oh, you're from Columbus. I didn't know. I think the first time that I encountered it, I also sort of was like, huh, the word myth seems weird. But then having thought about it, I think myth is a perfectly acceptable word to describe it. It's just that we tend not to think about our own culture's myths as myths. They're just stories to us. All right, this might tell me a little bit more. Here we have an abstract of the dissertation proposal. In the 1990s, I became aware of a seemingly odd series of events occurring within the environmentalist community, primarily but not necessarily on the margins of that community. In rhetorical positions with regard to Native peoples, I noticed an increasingly dissatisfied tone, is probably the best way to put it, in environmentalist commentaries on various Native nations' land use, timber harvesting, waste disposal, and other types of plans regarding Native territories. Much of the rhetoric focused on Native people's failure to live up to, or in reality, given the stereotypical nature of non-Native expectations of our peoples, live down to the environmentalist conceptions of the way Native ideals regarding their own lands were, and still are, constructed. As new controversies emerged, most notably the Wisconsin and Minnesota Native fisheries, the macaw whaling controversies, radical environmentalist groups were joined by animal rights fundamentalist groups, and then, perhaps surprisingly or perhaps not, by so-called wise use groups in opposing Native proposals for uses of their own lands. In particularly and problematically, one particular clarion call began to resound and continues to do so with increasing frequency throughout these otherwise antithetically oriented groups. Treaty rights are special rights. This planned dissertation will focus on the contemporary history of problems of ideologies created both at the center and the margins of the social mainstream, consisting primarily of conflicts between the ideologies of Native peoples committed to various ecological strategies in the various territories and the ideologies of non-Native animal rights environmentalist and anti-Native advocates engaged in significant opposition to Native self-determination and treaty rights. One extremely important topic to be examined is the confluence of rhetoric of groups ostensibly espousing vastly different agendas, the conference and conflation of anti-treaty rhetoric of conservative property owners groups, the our use of our lands is our business groups, on the one hand, and that of radical animal rightsists and environmentalists supposedly virulently opposed to such cavalier anti-conservationist groups when it comes to Native treaty rights. The arguments employed by animal rights environmentalists and anti-treaty fundamentalist thinkers and actors is, as individuals and as groups, will be scrutinized with closest attention paid to the mainstream non-Native institutions, educational, social, and authoritarian, that have created and that perpetuate the sense of white privilege that undergirds much of the rhetoric of these individuals and groups, and which inspires them to direct action against Native peoples involved in both traditional and modern territorial use plans. The ultimate purpose of this dissertation is to propose a functional pedagogy that engages and refutes the arguments of those in conflict with Natives engaged in various land use activities, self-determinative activities, and the protection of treaty rights in a manner that may be employed in a wide variety of situations facing Native peoples. Whew! Ah! I mean, that's also possible, Shadows, that you see myths as being about something magical or otherworldly and not about some guy in history. And in that case, I would, if you stipulate as your definition for myth that it needs to be magical or otherworldly, then yeah, I could definitely see how legend would be a more appropriate term. So, his doctoral work with the University of Arizona, focusing on environmental and treaty rights and the conflict that those cause with non-Native organizations. Let's see. I'm not sure what everything else in this collection is. I'm just looking to see what looks interesting. There are some language resources that I really want to get to before the end of stream, so I may try to get to those pretty soon. There's a folder here on Indian mascots. Terminology. I don't know if the terms... So this collection was processed. When was this collection processed? And it is quite common here to see the terminology American Indian, because American Indian Studies is the name of an academic program here and an academic discipline beyond here. So I assume that's why the term Indian gets used in labeling a lot of folders. What I don't know is whether this material came to us in folders, because if it did, then it's likely that the folder titles were the titles of the folders for Michael Two Horses' own filing system. And I do not have that information, so I don't know if, I don't know if that's his language or if that's the language of the person who was processing the collection. Let's see, this is a letter to the editor about, so we're looking at sports team mascots. Looks like there was a letter responding to an editorial. This is written by Professor Tom Holm. I think this is a research file, this one. Like, I think this folder is material that Michael Two Horses gathered to do research about the public discourse over indigenous mascots for sports teams. Y2K notice. Sorry. Definitely lets you know the approximate age of the page you're looking at, huh? U.S. Commission on Civil Rights on the Use of Native American Images and Nicknames as Sports Symbols. This is interesting. Is this dated? I'm going to assume this is probably from roughly the 2001 era, because everything else in the folder is, like, the documents on either side of it are, but Statement of the U.S. Commission on Civil Rights on the Use of Native American Images and Nicknames as Sports Symbols. The U.S. Commission on Civil Rights calls for an end to the use of Native American images and team names by non-Native schools. The Commission deeply respects the rights of all Americans to freedom of expression under the First Amendment and in no way would attempt to prescribe how people can express themselves. However, the Commission believes that the use of Native American images and nicknames in schools is insensitive and should be avoided. In addition, some Native American and civil rights advocates maintain that these mascots may violate anti-discrimination laws. These references, whether mascots and their performances, logos, or names, are disrespectful and offensive to American Indians and others who are offended by such stereotyping. They are particularly inappropriate and insensitive in light of the long history of forced assimilation that American Indian people have endured in this country. Since the civil rights movement of the 1960s, many overtly derogatory symbols and images offensive to American Indians have been eliminated. However, many secondary schools, post-secondary institutions, and a number of professional sports teams continue to use Native American nicknames and imagery. Since the 1970s, American Indian leaders and organizations have vigorously voiced their opposition to these mascots and team names because they mock and trivialize American Indian religion and culture. It is particularly disturbing that Native American references are still to be found in educational institutions. Whether elementary, secondary, or post-secondary, schools are places where diverse groups of people come together to learn not only the three R's, but also to interact respectfully with people from different cultures. The use of stereotypical images of Native Americans by educational institutions has the potential to create a racially hostile educational environment that may be intimidating to Indian students. American Indians have the lowest high school graduation rates in the nation and even lower college attendance and graduation rates. The perpetuation of harmful stereotypes may exacerbate these problems. The stereotyping of any racial, ethnic, religious, or other groups when promoted by our public educational institutions teach all students that stereotyping of minority groups is acceptable. A dangerous lesson in a diverse society, schools have a responsibility to educate their students. They should not use their influence to perpetuate misrepresentations of any culture or people. Children at the elementary and secondary level usually have no choice about which school they attend. Further, the assumption that a college student may freely choose another educational institution if she feels uncomfortable around Indian-based imagery is a false one. Many factors, from educational programs to financial aid to proximity to home, limit a college student's choices. It is particularly onerous if the student must also consider whether or not the institution is maintaining a racially hostile environment for Indian students. Yeah, there's another like two pages. I'm not going to read more of it, but it's interesting to me. Like this, that statement was released based on, again, the organization of the documents in here. It would date it to sometime around 2000-2001, and it wasn't until I believe last year that the Washington football team finally changed their mascot. So that argument is actually still a very active one. Let's see, I'm gonna open up the second box, because we've only looked at things from box one so far, and we are getting near to the end of the stream. Again, if there's anything listed in the finding aid that you are particularly interested in seeing, do let me know. Otherwise, I am gonna just pull a few things and we'll look at them. Photographs, poetry, powwows, those sound good. Yeah, okay. I think that's probably more than enough to get us to end of stream, but I can always, you know, set aside some of the things that I pulled if there's something that you want to see. Hi, Telly Highland. The first folder that I pulled out of box two is box two, folder two, Memorial Song, which, oh dear. I'm not sure I'm going to be able to say out loud, because I do not want to say it wrong, but way ya hey ya ya hey oh hey hey yo. This would be something that I would need to practice, but you can see the text on the screen there. It is definitely a rhythmic chant. It's got a lead, a verse, and a tail to it, and it is a memorial song for Mike Two Horses. So this, we have a number of copies of it in our collection, but it appears to be something that would have been used at his memorial after his death, which is sort of interesting to have it be inside the collection of his materials, because usually, like these are the Michael Two Horses papers. Usually it would just be his papers rather than like this item that would not have been collected by him because it's from after he passed. But I do see the relevance of having it in the collection. But yeah, to read this aloud on stream, I would need to practice it first. We do have a folder of photographs. I do not know for certain that there is a photograph of Michael Two Horses in here. Otherwise, I would have used it for like the streams this episode's like graphic, but I wasn't 100% certain. I suspect that there's a photo of him. I mean, I know there are a couple of photos that have him in them, but none that really worked for that purpose. We do have a photo here. Appears to be an indigenous woman with some beadwork on. Not labeled though. So beyond it just being a photo, I do not know any context for who this person is. And I'm sad that I don't, because that would be a nice thing to know. Again, I don't think there's any context given here for the people in the photo. I do think that some of these photos were probably also part of research files. I just don't know. Yours in the cause, Carlos Montezuma, M.D. Another just a person with long hair in some indigenous indigenous style clothing. The next one I do think actually is a photo of Michael. It's not labeled though, so I can't be 100% certain, but I believe it is. This one I'm fairly certain is Michael. And it's actually labeled on the back, but not to say who it is. But rather to talk about the photographic style of it. So I'll read. This is not an accident. It is what is known as a solarization, a print exposed again after developing starts. I did it myself, Michael. So I do believe that this is a self-portrait, or a selfie, if you will, that was developed using the solarization technique, but I don't know for certain that it is Michael. It's rather younger than the other photos that I have where I know for sure that it's Michael. But I suspect that this is actually a photograph of Michael. Yeah, I think as far as photographic style, the solarization of this photo, it appears to be well done, and it is sort of an interesting technique. Definitely produces a very particular stylistic photograph. This one's somewhat interesting and ties in with the folder that we were sort of glancing at before about sports teams' names. This is a diptych. Bill Brown Stadium, home of the Blacksburg Bruins. This appears to be like a, like the small, in a lot of smaller communities in the United States, they have amateur professional baseball teams. Sort of feeder teams into the National Baseball League. There will be like a local stadium with people who play baseball there semi-professionally. And apparently it was the Blacksburg Indians. And they renamed them to the Bruins, which meant that they only had to change some of the letters on the sign. Mm-hmm. cat. Here we do have an actual confirmed. It is 100% actually Michael Two Horses in this photograph on the left in the blue shirt. This is the person whose collection we are looking at today, the person on the left in this photograph. Yeah, a cat, just for reasons. So there is Michael on the left in the blue shirt. These are apparently Michael's dogs. I don't know what's going on in the photo, but... And then we have another photo here. Michael is in the foreground in the center with the guitar there. This is an unlabeled photo, so I won't. Dogs, also for reasons. I mean, yeah, why not? And then, so I've got some photos in here, and I just don't, this is clearly like a professional photo, but I'm uncertain who it is. It might be possible with like some reverse image searching to track it down if there are other photos of this person that made their way onto the internet. I just don't know. Not labeled as Michael, I would have to get like a facial expert to be able to tell if this was him, because the only photos, like I said, that I know of where I know for certain it's him are older. Another photograph where no idea who the person is or why they're in the collection. But I did like the solarization one that I'm fairly certain is Michael, but is unlabeled as being him, just labeled as being his work as a photographic developer. Let's see, where are we on time? So there's a folder here called Poetry. And it includes some writings from Michael. I'm going to read one of them that is in this folder called Poetry, but is in fact song lyrics. Which, I guess, song lyrics without music is poetry. So, this one is titled Give Us Back Our Country. By Mike Two Horses, copyright 2001, hardly used music. And this is their edits on it. I do not know what the final version would have been. Awful or frightful things have happened, as they always seem to do. Some folks are reacting or waiting for the other shoe. Fear is in the air around here and sometimes in the mail. So they've gathered up the different folks and run them off to jail. We always seem to look for ways we're not the same as them. We always want to look for ways to blame. And we don't seem quite inclined to trust the foreign mind, even when the different one is really just the same. We don't need to tear apart our way of living. We don't need to put up bars to keep us free. But we need to tell those folks who keep on passing hateful laws to give us back our country before we don't recognize it no more. Take away my freedoms, take away my voice. It don't really matter. The Supreme Court took my choice. Take away my right to speak and disagree with some, and just come and take away, my body from my home. In this place we call the world's great melting pot, we find that we're not as melted as we thought. Some of us think there's an us, and some of us think there's a them. But God above just sighs and rolls his eyes a lot. repeat chorus, repeat, or insert bridge. We don't need to tear apart our way of living. We don't need to put up bars to keep us free. But we need to tell those folks who keep on passing hateful laws to give us back our country before we don't recognize it no more. Instrumental break, then. Take away the problem. Don't support bad men. Don't give nothing to the tyrants who give nothing to the children. Turn our backs on kings and princes. Turn toward the folks in need. Help them to see an America that doesn't live on greed. Let them see that we don't care the name of God they choose. Let them see that all together, none of us can lose. Make a world where everyone has laces and has shoes, enough to eat, warm place to sleep, and the right for themselves to choose. And then it does the second bridge and the chorus again. But when I was looking for an image to use for this collection, as sort of the featured item. Hi, Key Squared. Yeah, you got in just before the end. When I was looking for an item to sort of feature for this collection, I had just seen the news about the latest with regard to the latest school shooting to make major headlines. And I know that there are a lot of people out there who are scared because of changing laws and such. And this really sort of struck me as something relevant to our time today that was located in this collection. So I chose to highlight it. Yeah, there should definitely be stuff in the VOD. The VOD should be available immediately, and if not, then if you don't get to it right away, it'll make its way to the library's YouTube channel. We have just a few minutes left. I do want to just highlight this one because I. One of the things that is in here, there are two folders of resources on the Lakota language, as well as a folder on Diné, which is the Navajo language. And like these are published resources, or this is a published resource. I don't know how accessible the Navajo language or the Lakota language is. I know Diné, the Navajo language, is a bit more accessible than some other indigenous languages, but there has been a push to try and make sure that language resources and are documented, and especially beyond written texts like this, because these written texts are fine. But having actual recordings of people speaking the words is invaluable. And in the last couple of years I'm trying to remember details, doesn't always happen. I believe in Brazil, there was a major fire in an archives and they had the only copies of a number of language resources regarding some indigenous languages that are gone because of that fire. Clearly this is a published resource. This is not an extremely irreplaceable primary source that would be sort of in the same vein as the irreplaceable resources that were lost in that fire. But sort of older languages are dying out in a number of cases, and a lot of indigenous languages are dying out specifically because of efforts to erase indigenous culture in trying to forcefully assimilate people into culture. And this is a history that's here in the United States, it's in Canada, it's in a number of countries in South America, where indigenous culture, including indigenous language, were forcibly removed from children by removing them from their families and educating them in places, often in residential schools, that had a very bad history that is just coming to light in the US and has been revealed in Canada. And so language resources like this are especially useful for people who are trying to reconnect to their ancestral culture. And in fact, a number of indigenous languages are available from places like Duolingo, Mango, or Rosetta Stone, where they've actually put together courses to help people learn, and in some cases worked specifically with tribal nations to make language courses and make them financially available to members of the tribe in order to sort of revive and preserve that culture. And so that's part of why I wanted to just like end by looking at and highlighting some of the language stuff, because I think it is one of the more important things. And it's not without its own problems. The documentation of indigenous languages was not always done with the best of intentions. Some of the actual recordings that you can get, or notes, primary sources that are available about Native languages, were collected by people who were involved in the oppression of the culture. So there's some sort of mixed, like it's great that they were collected and that there's documentation of them, but the people who were collecting them were very problematic. So exploring history can be a mix of emotions sometimes, and especially when you get into history about historically marginalized populations, a lot of the documentation that you have will be from people who are not part of that group. That's one of the reasons why I like this collection. This collection is not the ideal collection. It is not what one would hope to have. It is a lot of research file, like stuff that Michael Two Horses had gathered for his own research in order to support his instruction or work that he was doing, rather than things authored by him, which is always something more interesting with regard to an archival collection. But it is a collection of materials about indigenous topics that was collected by an indigenous scholar and educator. And that makes it invaluable. It is also, as far as I am aware, the only indigenous collection we have in our collections here, which makes it especially important, at least here in our archives. I wish we had more. I'm going to go ahead and steer us towards the end of the stream. We'll look at who we're going to be rating today and what we'll be looking at next week. I do want to say thank you all very much for joining me today. Thank you, 16-bit Eric, for bringing the Whimsies over to join the stream. Let me go ahead and pop us back to this so that my face is larger than I'd like on the screen, but it's fine. I do want to thank you all for joining me today. I have two more streams planned in the month of June, and then I will be off for 2 weeks. Next week, is as close as we get to the anniversary of Fortran. And there is a collection here about that. So June 8th is the anniversary of Fortran. It first appeared in 1957. We have a collection from the 80s about the, I believe it's the 25th anniversary of Fortran collection. And when I saw that title, I was like, well, I need to know what's in that collection. I'm very curious. Let's plan on doing a stream about that. And so I have that planned for as close as I could get to the actual anniversary. I'm just double checking, waiting for a window to open here. Yes, it is the 1982 celebration of 25 years of Fortran collection that we're gonna look at next week, because I'm quite curious about the 1982 celebration of 25 years of Fortran collection. I don't know what to expect from it. I've never seen inside of it, and I'm curious. And then, on June 15th, which will be our last stream before July, the last stream before I take 2 weeks of much-needed vacation, I have planned Herschel Somerville and Marcette, three 19th century women scientists, because there was a request from a viewer to feature some works by Jane Marcette, and we have a couple of those, and I'm also gonna pull out Catherine Herschel and Somerville, whose first name I can't think of at the moment, but contemporaries who were also scientists and women publishing in the 19th century. Tully, I'm not sure what you're not sure what is. Fortran is a if that's what you're asking about, it's a computer programming language. Mary Somerville. So if you're asking about, if you were saying you're not sure what Fortran is, that is a computer programming language. Yes. Yeah, it is a general purpose programming language. So we'll be learning about it next week. If you want a basic primer, there's the Wikipedia article. But yeah, that's where we're gonna be for the next 2 weeks. Let me go ahead and set up a raid to close this out. I don't know who all is streaming today. Let's just see. I don't know if the aquarium is even on right now, which is where we usually go. It does look like they are. So I think we will head over to the aquarium. They have the kelp forest cam today. So hopefully that will be some nice chill times for you for the rest of your Wednesday. I do want to thank everybody for coming. And I hope that I will see you at a future stream. Until I see you again, I hope that you continue having adventures with history. I hope you enjoyed what I presented today, and that I will see you again soon.